Thank you for a very kind introduction. So in this presentation, I will be going over the value of integrating facility assessment and inspection, what is included in a manufacturing assessment, and how it supports regulatory action. We will go over why we integrated facility assessment at OPMA to make it more comprehensive manufacturing assessment. What do we consider for review and inspection? What do we expect from each manufacturing site? I will also go over some commonly found manufacturing and inspection deficiencies and what you can do at your facilities to mitigate this risk. I will be presenting two case studies to go over these concepts. At OPQ, we use a team-based integrated quality assessment where we are inclusive of drug substance, drug product, biopharm, manufacturing, etc., so as to maximize each team member's expertise. In terms of manufacturing, we started comprehensive evaluation of manufacturing processes, wherein we combined process and facility assessments together in conjunction with either pre or post approval inspections to understand facility capability, compliance status, and to make informed decision on an application. For manufacturing assessment, we assess the manufacturing operations which could impact product quality attributes or CQAs, critical quality attributes. So when we perform our review, we look at all the information pertaining to material impact on the processes, the unit operations itself, and controls, hold time, executed master batch record, and some other information. And from all this, we look from the perspective of whether you have selected a suitable process and is that process scalable. Now, since we are integrated, we also make determination in OPMA whether the site needs a pre-approval inspection or can we defer it to a post-approval inspection. Or the site doesn't need any inspection at all. We can approve its application without any inspection. So to make that determination, we use certain criteria as listed here. I want to put emphasis on some of them here. Like for example, if establishment is named for the first time or it is a first application filed by you, then we will trigger a pre-approval inspection. We also trigger pre-approval inspection if the dosage form is new than previously approved at your facility, or there are product or process related concerns. Some process related concerns we have seen is lack of controls that we see from your application, or we do not have adequate information that you are capable of manufacturing this product once the application will be approved. So for example, we have some scale up concern or concern about your quality systems in general based on the facility history. So we might trigger a pre-approval inspection in those cases. So it is mainly focused on risk-based decision-making on pre-approval inspection. Some of them we can defer to post-approval stage wherein we approve the application without any inspection, but we do trigger inspection after the application is approved, which is within certain time frame. Or as I say, we may not need inspection at all for certain facilities. So to make this decision on application, what do we need from you? So we need an entire list of manufacturers and their responsibilities. So for manufacturers, we need a list of all the drug substance, drug product, all the testing sites for drug substance and drug product, their FEI number, and their responsibilities. Of course, we also need process description, necessary bridging, development data, control strategy, and sufficient data so that we can make informed decisions. For sterile products, we do need validation package. Now, just to give you a snapshot, we also perform our own risk assessment for manufacturing when we receive your application, where we individualize risk assessment per facility. So we take into consideration not only the process risk, but also facility experience or any data concerns for the unit operation CQA combinations. We have developed a quantitative risk assessment framework which uses failure mode and effect analysis, wherein we have a series of questions. Some of them are common for all facilities and all unit operations, whereas some questions are specific for unit operation and specific for a facility. So we have divided these questions and we have given a background score. The reviewer answers based on the application, either yes or no to this question, and the background algorithm calculates the score. And then it is bucketed into three different risks ranking, which is low, medium, and high. If it is low risk ranking for that unit operation, we can use shorter version of our assessment. Whereas if it is high risk, we use a full assessment. So depth of our assessment will depend on the risk that is identified for each unit operation. And for each unit operation, actually, we have presented the unit operation CQA relationships. So here, the next slide will show that relationship. So for example, we have a unit operation one, consider this as a blending. And we know that blending could impact mainly assay and content uniformity. Whereas there is a second unit operation, which is compression, and it may also impact dissolution. So we look at that relationships, and if the unit operation has the risk on those CQAs, then we assess accordingly in our application. So we are using this risk-based approach for evaluating the assessment. And this furthers our priority of modernizing frameworks for assessment of regulated products in a smart way. It also makes us use limited resources in an efficient manner. So if we identify a need for a pre-approval inspection, what do? So we go with these three objectives which are in this pie chart. So first one is readiness for commercial manufacture, and we do look at all your incoming material, equipments, facilities, cleaning, personnel training, competence, etc. The second objective for us is conformance to application, wherein we look at the data which is presented in application that is submitted to us is actually being conducted at the site. Third most important thing that we look from pre-approval inspection perspective is data integrity. And I will be covering this in some detail in coming slides. So just to make sure, what do we need from you to make this initial recommendation? So we need to make sure that when you submit your sites in 356H form, you have check mark that they are ready for inspection. We need all the sites to be compliant with CGMPs. Of course, if it is a new site or it's the first time, this will be absent, but we will be triggering an inspection for those new sites. We would want to make sure that you submit in the applications those operations that you are conducting at the facility. So that needs to be there, and data should be accurate, whatever you are presenting. So these are some of the most important things that we look to make sure that we have what we need in terms of assessing the manufacturing operations and they are fit for the purpose. So I know this is a quite busy slide, but let me dissect it further because I think it is important to go over to make you understand what do we do once you submit your application to us. So just to walk you through this slide, IQA team conducts entire application risk assessment for CMC part. For OPMA, we conduct our manufacturing risk assessment, as I showed earlier, using FMEA framework, using firm's history, firm's capability, and manufacturing unit operation risk controls, and we make our own risk assessment decisions. So once that is done, we use risk-based approaches to make inspection decision, whether we need a pre-approval inspection or we can defer a post-approval inspection or we don't need an inspection at all. So if we determine that if there is no inspection needed, we would review as usual and send you information request or deficiency deficiencies under DRL or under complete response, depending on the timeline of the application. You can respond within defined time frame if it is IR or DRL, and we would consider those responses, review if they are received within the time frame, and make decision. However, if we determine that inspection is needed, OPMA will share this inspection risk and decision with ORA. ORA concurs with us, and then they schedule a pre-approval inspection. We have started using another process, 704A4, in lieu or in conjunction with inspection, and Mahesh will be going over in the next presentation, so I'm not going to go over that. So once the inspection is scheduled, ORA lead and IQA team member, SME, may join the inspection, and they conduct an inspection. So once that inspection is conducted, they start writing EIR report. But what happens at facilities, if we found some issues, we issue the 483 to the firm. ORA will provide initial field recommendation to OPMA as well as to the firm. Once you have your 483, you can respond to write it in writing to district office within certain time frame. If we have the responses received in time, we take everything into consideration, like we take a look at EIR report if we haven't participated on inspection. We take a look at 483, your response to 483. We may have some outstanding questions still, and we can provide a request for further information to the forms that is issued by OPMA after a pre-approval inspection, and you can respond within defined time frame. We review those and make our final facility recommendations, and that is fed into the IQA team to make a decision on the application. Now, let's look at some of the most common issues that can lead to information request or complete response letters for manufacturing. So from process point of view, some of them are listed here. We might require you to make new batches depending on the risk that we have perceived or risk that we have seen. And then there is a lack of information, lack of root cause identification, lack of investigation. Then we might require, and that may result in a complete response letter. Occasionally we see incomplete facility or facility responsibility is not listed in 356H form. We will do an early information request. Sometimes we find from DMF review that there are hidden DMF facilities. For example, drug substance testing or particle size testing is being conducted at a different facility than DMF holder that is listed in DMF. However, it never made to your 356H form. And we are seeing it more often than so it has become a regular routine that we see that deficiency. We see quite a lot of time lack of process parameters and in-process controls, and they are not supported by your development data that you have proposed. Sometimes scale-up information is missing. We have seen those issues. So let's go over one example of what manufacturing deficiency will look like. So from 68 reviews, we data mined from NDAs and ANDAs for past 3 years for one unit operation only. We focused on high shear wet granulation process in OPMA, and we looked through applications, and we looked through all the deficiencies or information requests submitted to the firms. From that, we saw that lack of process parameters or in-process control was most frequently cited information request or deficiency for these reviews. So for granulation, it could range from lack of endpoint control to lack of appropriate fluid level, etc. And I should say that this is not unique only to wet granulation process, but we have seen this happening for all different types of processes, and we are having another project where we are in the process of identifying all the common manufacturing deficiencies for modified release products. We will get those out to you soon. Some of the commonly found deficiencies on pre-approval inspection, they are bucketed as per the three objectives that I had described earlier. So first objective is commercial manufacturer readiness. So we have seen when we go on pre-approval inspection that the firm, although they check mark that they are ready for inspection or ready for manufacture, but in reality, they are not ready for manufacturing. Often we have seen that commercial equipments are not even there at the site, or they are not ready. For example, they are not qualified. Then there are some unresolved failures observed in tech transfer. Then there is inadequate scale-up strategy that are present at the firm. Some of the analytical methods that you have submitted in your data package in your application are not validated. Then we see a lot of times inadequate quality practices, and they are bucketed under these three bullet points, where we see that there were failures, there were out of trend, but you haven't conducted adequate investigation, or your CAPAs are not effective. Also, we have seen on frequent occasion that there is an inadequate operator training and knowledge. So those are all under the not ready to commercial manufacture. The second objective for us on PAI is conformance to application. And when we go on site, we see that the actual equipments that are used for manufacturing exhibit batches are very different than what you have listed in your application, which is present with us, or you have implemented some controls which are not present in the application. You never amended your application. There are some changes made on site which never made it to application. So that gives rise to some deficiencies for this particular objective. Third is data integrity. This is becoming normal that we see that there are inadequate OOSs, hiding of OOSs, then the failed results are not present in the application. Sometimes we see testing into compliance. So that gives, and any of these deficiencies could result in withhold of an application. So just to go over quickly some case study. First case study is for modified release tablet, where the laser drilling process is used. So it is an osmotically controlled pump, and this drilling operation is very important for drug release or drug dissolution. So when we reviewed the application, we saw that there was a lack of control for the whole depth during laser drilling process. We triggered an inspection, and on inspection, we observed that laser power level was identified as critical. However, it was neither monitored nor recorded. We discussed with the firm. The firm got 483. They responded in time. We reviewed, and we saw that the firm mitigated by implementing this laser power control. They revised the application also, and the application could get approved. This is a second case study where there was again a PAI trigger for a new product. The facility had poor compliance history for another product type, but for this new product, we never had any inspection history, so we went on inspection. When we went there, we saw some concerns over testing failures. So that gave rise to looking at adjacent facility where the tests were being conducted for the lab. And we saw that there were a lot of problems with the data. Results were either hidden or some OOSs were never reported. Then we were seeing that some dissolution time points were completely missing. We issued 483, firm could not respond in time, and it went over as a complete response letter. So what can you do at your facility to mitigate? You can operate within state of control. You can review your events, understand trends, do adequate investigation when needed, have enough documentation, and make sure that whatever you are presenting is supported by scientific evidence. It's very important to have a robust pharmaceutical quality system. Without that, we cannot really have confirmation that you will be able to manage your application product at your facility. And also have adequate methods to control raw data and prevent data integrity issues, which is very, very important that I really want to emphasize here. So with this, I hope you got what I wanted to convey regarding this manufacturing assessment and what you can do to mitigate the risks that we see during our review and assessment and pre-approval inspection. With this, I thank you for your attention. I will turn it over to Mahesh now. Thank you.